welcome you to the 60th Information Value Chain Breakfast Forum hosted by Digital Dwells. Before we kick off, I'd like to invite the Head of Standards Consulting at Digital Dwells, Michael John Osarens, to lead us in an opening prayer.
Good morning, everybody. In Jesus' name, Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this event. Thank you for everyone that's gathered here, all the objectives, all the goals that we hope to achieve, the questions that will be asked, the learning that will be taking us through, we receive in the name of Jesus. Thank you because we know that we're going out strong. We're going to succeed in all our endeavors. We give you praise for as many that are still on their way. You quicken their steps, and this will be a learning experience for each and every one of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you very much, Michael. Before we kick off, I'd just like us to take a few minutes to turn to the person beside and just introduce yourself. If you're from the same organization, don't look at them. Look at somebody else. And then just take a few minutes to introduce yourself, get to know them. What do they do? So take a few minutes, talk. What do you do in your organization? What organization do you work with? If you've got your cards, you can exchange a few cards. You don't know the things that can start off from a simple introduction. Might be the person you've been looking for all along. You see, I'm seeing a few R's on the table. It's like, so you're the one. Okay, so welcome once again. As I said earlier, this is the 60th in the series of the Information Value Chain Breakfast Forums, which started in 2008. And since 2008, we've run 60. This is 59 of this session. The session we're in today is the 60th one. Since 2008, we used to run the sessions every month. It used to be monthly sessions up until the 50th one. At the 50th session, we decided, because it was difficult to find high-value speakers to speak every month, to now begin to run. It became difficult to get speakers to speak every month, so we started to run the quarterly sessions now. And these quarterly sessions have been running since the 50th IVC session. And I make bold to say that since we've been running the sessions, we've never had a representative come to speak at the sessions. All the invited guests that we've had have always shown up for the sessions, which I think is an achievement in itself that is worth a round of applause, because it's not easy within the business context within Nigeria to always have speakers. When you have speakers from government, from private sector, and these are top-level executives, like the speaker we have today. The Information Value Chain Breakfast Forum has been a platform for knowledge sharing, information exchange, and networking. And over the years, discussions in the sessions have cut across areas around organizational development, talking about best practice standards, corporate stories, and entrepreneurships, and has had speakers from all walks of the industry, from every sector, from finance to telecoms to oil and gas to private sector entrepreneurs. Across the regulators, the players within the industry, we've always had them. And as I said before, we've never had cases of representation to the sessions. We've run the sessions in Lagos and in Abuja. The session has also produced quite a number of deliverables, two of which include the publications of which we call the Chronicles of Thought Leaders around the IVC Breakfast Forums, which is a publication of the presentations and the thoughts of the thought leaders who are shared in the breakfast forums that we've had before. So we've got two publications. We have the volume one, which was launched at the 40th IVC session, and we've got the volume two, which was launched at the 50th session, which also coincided with the award of the ISMS, the ISO 27000 award to Digital Dwells. We also had, last year, we launched our web TV channel, which is the scoopIT.tv channel, which is a web TV channel that provides a platform to exchange information that is shared within the Breakfast Forum, including interviews as well with thought leaders within the IT industry, within industries that cut across the information value chain. And it's a very rich platform that you get a lot of knowledge, so feel free to visit it. It's scoopIT.tv, S-C-O-O-P-I-T.tv. We'll show up what the link to that is. And also, we launched last year a series of training videos around information security awareness, which were called the Secure Sense videos, training videos that would help organizations to boost information security awareness within the organizations, or general governance, risk, and compliance awareness within the organization. So we had that launch last year, which was the, I think it was the Q3 IVC session, which was the 58th IVC session where we had that launch. So this morning we'll be taking a slightly different topic, but still in line with all of the discussions that we've had from the previous sessions. So sometime 2 or 3 years ago, the Central Bank of Nigeria launched this document, which was called the IT Standards Blueprint. And it sent the industry into a frenzy. What exactly is the blueprint about? What is expected of us? What are we expected to comply with? What should we do? What should we achieve? I know it sent that frenzy across the industry and across industries that offer services to the industry, across the information and the financial value chain. So this morning, what we'll be doing is we'll be trying to demystify that standard. And we've got in the session this morning, the Director of Shared Services at the Central Bank of Nigeria, who will be spending the next few minutes demystifying the blueprint standard and telling us about what is expected from the what the regulator expects from the standards, and also how we can achieve better compliance or better understanding what the standards expect of us. So I'd like to introduce a man who needs no introduction. I wonder why people say that just before they introduce somebody. Well, he's somebody who needs no introduction. So I'd like us to put our hands together as I introduce Mr. Chidi Umeano, the Director of Shared Services at the Central Bank of Nigeria.
Good morning, everybody. I'm here this morning to try and make a presentation on CBN IT Standard Blueprint. I didn't know it was a mystery. I don't know what about demystifying. I'll just try to explain the background and what we expect from IT standards. If the introduction as a staff in Shared Services Office of the Central Bank of Nigeria, I think it's important to just take us a bit back so that we understand what we are trying to achieve when we talked about shared services, or when it was introduced in CBN about three years ago. When we had the economic meltdown, world meltdown in 2008-2007, something became very clear and apparent in Nigeria's financial system. We realized that a lot of the Nigerian banks were lending monies to oil and gas upstream, downstream, and then also lending money to stock markets. It was clear to us that the problem was where they thought they could get returns. And the cost of banking business had become high. Interest rates were high, people just could not cope anymore, and we said to ourselves, what is it that we can do as a regulator to help and assist the financial sector? And we came up with an idea of shared services. We engaged some people to look at the cost drivers in the industry. They came out with over 40 cost drivers where we can actually make some savings. Then CBN, working with Bankers Committee at the time, decided and took 5 of the initiatives that we're going to work on them. And hopefully, at the time, we had hoped that by the year 2015, we'll be able to reduce the industry cost to serve by 30%. The 5 initiatives that we undertook working with Bankers Committee were transforming the payment system. That's why we have cashless. That's why we have all the revolution we have today in the payment space. We had IT standards. We had IT infrastructure. We are trying to get the banks to share some infrastructure in terms of backups, in terms of disaster recovery. We're also trying to get the banks to share what we call back office operations. That is what, there's somebody here from NIPS. That's what we have done using the check truncation. That's what we're trying to do with the biometrics. These are part of back office services. So these are the kind of stuff we're trying to do with shared services office. So today we are trying to see and understand what we have come up with in IT standards. Let me say quickly that for the purpose of this discussion, I will define a standard. I will define a standard as an established, measurable, and achievable set of criteria agreed by general consent to be a basis of comparison. There is no law. People come together, agree on a set of criteria, and boom, it becomes a basis of comparison. So that's really what standard is for what we're trying to do. But basically, we know from experience and what we know today that IT has transformed the way we do business. And what that means is that there's a results in the evolution of new business architectures and different types of approach to customer service, enterprise management, and of course, regulatory compliance. IT spend in Nigeria today, especially in the financial services sector, is huge. There's no doubt about it. I remember when I was CIO in Diamond Bank, I think we used to pay a close to 200 million naira every quarter just for links. And one of the beneficiaries is here, James Agada from, they used to supply half of it. You know, and today, I can tell you for free that one of the big banks in Nigeria spends over 650 million naira every quarter just on link connectivity in their banks. So IT spend is not a joke in this country today. So anything we can do to help reduce the cost, anything we can do to help reduce the amount will be very, very welcome. So and we know that even with this high expense, do we actually get commensurate value? So basically, we understand why we don't get the value. We think it's because we have complex, duplicated, non-standard, that's the key word here, non-standard and costly processes, non-standard systems and infrastructure, inefficiency of electronic information exchange, data integrity issues. I'll come to that information exchange. I think we had a meeting and some guy from one of the banks was telling me how they used to have about 12 to 18 interfaces in their bank. Any transaction they want to do, you have to like quickly come out, log into another one and do it. Come out, log into another one and do it. If you want to do quick teller, if you want to do payment by some other supplier, some other service provider, you need to just keep changing and changing. And we're saying, if we had a standard that everybody follows, because once we agree on it, it becomes beholden on us to make sure that our third-party suppliers also adhere to it. And therefore, it becomes easy to interchange and interface their data. Industry leverage of IT lacks global leading practices and is limiting banking operating efficiency. To address this gap and provide guidelines for application and utilization of information technology, industry IT standards were defined to articulate and provide a point of reference. It's very key. We needed to do that in Nigeria. Okay, so prior to what we are trying to do, there were no defined IT standards driving interoperability, information exchange, system integration, amongst others in the industry. And this has massive implications for what we do. One of them is that there's a high cost of integration. We know that every bank, for example, will have interface with NIPS, will interface with SWIFT, InterSwitch, CBN. We know all that. But if we all have different stuff in our entire system setup, it becomes very costly. It becomes hard to interface. So these are the kind of things we are trying to say, that if we have a defined standard that every bank is following, it becomes easy to just hook into things when they come and when the need arises. Interoperability and automation to drive straight through processing cannot be achieved leading to islands of automation but no integration. Quality and maturity of IT cannot be ascertained, having no reference points to benchmark against. Poor customer experiences of back IT infrastructure due to absence of minimum IT standards driving governance, service management, and infrastructure. And then, of course, because of all that, there's ad hoc implementation of CBN and regulatory policies and then plans around it. So, having said all this, what do we consider as the benefits of IT standard? We say that if the industry implements the IT standards as spelled out in our CBN/Bankers Committee blueprint for the industry, We expect that there be increased uptime and availability of banks leading to increased cost savings. Establishment of a reference point for objective assessment of the IT function, leading to improved IT performance measurement. Improved data integrity and electronic format information exchange. All these things, if you take them, by the time we go to different types of standards that we have, you begin to see how all these things come into play. When we say increased uptime and availability, you can tie it to so many things. The ISO 7001, where you have the security, if you are doing a PC DSS, if you are also doing tier 3 data center, for example, we expect more uptime. Because once you have followed these standards that we have set for ourselves, it means that downtime will be minimized. We have improved data integrity, of course. There will be increased efficiency and productivity of staff. There will be business continuity and recovery, and reduced risk of prolonged downtimes. We improve our data security assurance to customers, leading to increased customer confidence. Now, when we set out to do this, we thought to ourselves, we are not living on an island. Let's actually know what other countries are doing. And we can tell you categorically that this is just a list. We have a lot more, but we think we have certain things to share with these economies. And we took them. And there's nothing to say about it. Every country has sort of imposed or tried to enforce or drive certain standards within their local industry. It makes sense because that's the only way it can regulate properly. That's the only way it can protect the industry. That's the only way it can get things done. So clearly, it's not only Nigeria. Everybody is doing the same thing, trying to make sure they regulate and enforce certain IT standards to make them recover when there is a problem, to help them make them interoperable, and then enhance service delivery. So what are these IT capability areas? Let me confess up front that there are 1,001 of them, but we have selected to work with about 7 key areas. We have the strategic IT alignment. When we go further, we see the reference and we see the reference to these ones that we're talking about. When we talk about IT strategic IT alignment, we are saying, how do you translate a business vision and their strategies into a multi-year IT investment and operating plans, as well as impacts of information technology on enterprise performance measurement? Because sometimes people just keep pouring money on technology. I know it happens. Without being able to derive the benefits, how is the strategy done, how is follow-up, the investment that has been made, how do you follow through? It's very important. It may look simple because we think we know what we're doing, but what happens is that anything that comes up, people just go out and put in money without following a laid-down process to get it done. Then the IT governance. There must be a framework for initiation, endorsement, sponsorship, ownership, approval, and evaluation of IT decisions. It's very key. I know that the standard thing in most banks would be to maybe have a steering committee and then have the middle-level management and then have the operators. But I think there could be a lot more layers that will look into what we're doing to follow the process all the way down. Then you have the architecture and information management. This guides us on how to create and execute the strategic IT architecture framework. We have solutions delivery. This is also very, very important. This is a framework for the development of software application solutions and their subsequent transition into production environment. Sometimes certain departments just come together and say, listen, we need to do this in our HR. Can you help us do something?